In this lecture, we're going to introduce the Grassmann math, and it is done because we've studied now about the path integral formulation of field theory, and we know that now the Dirac field, the fermions that we are talking about, obeys the anti-symmetric property. If you take the wave function of two fermions and interchange them, that they gain a minus sign. They are anti-symmetric with respect to each other, right? So therefore, we need to integrate, to incorporate that into our path integral formulation. We need a certain kind of mathematics. That is what we have by means of the Grassmann math. Now, we have two numbers. We call them Grassmann numbers, and they obey this fundamental anti-symmetric property. Now, if it were the same number, it will be that the square of the number is equal to zero. Right, this follows just from this identity, this definition. So now, if eta square is zero, then any general function of eta can be Taylor expanded, and it will be this quantity, because n square is zero, so all the higher order terms will become zero. Our higher order above n square will become zero. So if you Taylor expand it, this is the general function. This is the most general function you can have of any function of eta. Now, we know that there is the shifting property of this ordinary integrals, right? So this is a definite integral. We have the shifting property, right? So if you have f of x, you replace x by x plus c, then it is both the integrals are equal to each other. So we insist that the Grassmann integral of this function of a beta also obeys this shifting property. So we shift it by a small Grassmann number z. Okay, so this is Greek symbol is not called z, it's actually pronounced as x. Okay, so you shift it, so eta x, so we shift it by a small value, and it turns out that both the integrals are the same. We insist that they should be the same, because that is what we see in the ordinary case of ordinary integrals. But for this integral, for this condition to be true, then we must have that this integral is equal to zero. Because for this function f of eta, we are plugging in this function, and when we do that, we find that this integral should be equal to zero. Now, since this Greek symbol x is a arbitrary number, we can expect this number, this integral, to be zero only when this integral, eta b is equal to zero, where b is a ordinary number. You see here, b is a ordinary number. So in that case, we take this number b to be one, and we define a condition such that dn, the integral dn, is equal to zero, where the number b is taken here to be one. Okay, so this is one of the rules of Grassmann integral. So this is the first rule. Okay, so this is one of the first rules. So the second rule, now we will see what is the argument for the second rule. So we have now three Grassmann numbers. We have three Grassmann numbers, chi, eta, and xi. Okay, so the three Grassmann numbers, three Greek letters for them, chi, eta, and xi. So what we see that is this number, when eta and chi, okay, and eta and chi are taken together, it commutes with this number. Okay, it commutes with this number. So therefore, we can say that the product of two Grassmann numbers, because it commutes, we can say that the product of these two Grassmann numbers is an ordinary number, because they are commuting. So ordinary numbers commute, right? So ordinary numbers commute. So if I write pi into 2, it is the same as saying, if I write pi into 2, it is the same as saying 2 into 5, right? So Grassmann numbers don't commute, right? So we saw that eta, if you take two Grassmann numbers, there, if you interchange their order, they gain a negative sign. But here, the product, when you take the product of two Grassmann numbers, it commutes with any Grassmann number. So you can say the product of two Grassmann numbers is a ordinary number. Therefore, this integral, which is dn multiplied, the integral dn multiplied by, d eta multiplied by eta, is just an ordinary number, okay, which we simply take to be 1. Okay, so here you can see it's a product, eta and integration of eta. Okay, eta is integrated with respect to eta, dn eta multiplied by eta. So it should be an ordinary number, which we simply take to be 1. So these are our two rules for integration. Okay, for Grassmann integration, very simple two rules are there. So when we integrate any function of eta, this general function of eta, we have already seen what is the general, most general function of eta. What answer we get is b, if we take this b to be an ordinary number. Okay, and if f of n is Grassmannian, that means a and b are Grassmannian numbers, then we have minus b. Okay, if we have, the answer is minus b. So why are we doing all this? We essentially want to calculate this Gaussian integral, because that is what we get the path integral in the form of these Gaussian integrals. So in case of these Grassmannian numbers, right, we want to calculate this Gaussian integral, because we are going to deal with fermions in Dirac field, which obey this Grassmannian algebra, or that they, when you interchange, they get the negative sign, right? So this integral, so this type of integral, this Gaussian integral, in according to the Grassmann rules, we have is equal to this quantity a, or e times log of a, which is nothing but a itself. Okay, so this is what we have. Now, if we have more, if you take eta to be going from eta 1 to eta n, okay, then we will have a quantity like this. Okay, so that this is determinant of a, not just a, this is a determinant of a consisting of all our values of a that we get. Now, so remember, we had done something like this, we had seen a formula like this before, right? So we had seen the Gaussian integral that we need to calculate in the case of path integrals. So now we have to introduce the Gaussian integral in terms of Grassmannian numbers. So that is what we have done. So as I said, this Grassmannian map is going to be used in the case of a spinor field, right? The Dirac field, the fermions, which obey the anti-symmetric property. So this is the Dirac Lagrangian written out here. Psi hat, okay, so the psi bar and psi are the two fields, so they obey this anti-symmetric property, and we had already evaluated. So this is a Gaussian integral, so we just evaluated how to do this Gaussian integral here, right? So we said it is equal to the determinant of a, so therefore we have the determinant of a is this quantity that we have here, and we can also write it as e of trace of log of a, right? So nothing but, so the determinant is nothing but the trace of its eigenvalues, right? So determinant is nothing but the product of its eigenvalue, right? So therefore, so this is the usefulness of this Grassmannian numbers and Grassmannian math. So it is used in writing the spinor field, right? The spinor, the fermion Dirac field in path integral formalism, and it helps in the path integral formalism of the Dirac field. Okay, so thank you for watching, and do subscribe to our channel for more videos like this.